Thank you.
Under 49E bracket 9, I will not put any question on the motion. Debate on motions with no legislative effect. The motion debate on urgently improving public health care services in Kowloon East. Members who wish to speak in the motion debate will please press the request to speak button. I now call upon Mr. Wilson Orr to speak and move the motion. Mr. Orr. Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. This motion debate is on urgently improving public health care services in Kowloon East. Life is priceless. A responsible, committed government will have to attach a lot of importance on health care services. Public health care services is a safety net, is very important. However, regrettably, public health care services cannot meet demand. Kowloon East is a serious, is a hard hit area. We want more resources devoted to improve the overall public health care services. We all know that we have an increasing demand for two reasons. First, an increasing population. Two, a rapidly aging population. According to projections, by 2043, we have 8.22 million people. One out of three people in 20 years' time will be an elderly citizen. And I would like to say that according to statistics and projection, the population increase and aging rate of Kowloon East is the highest. In Kwun Tong, in the past 10 years, we have seen more people living there than other districts. In Wong Tai Sin, Kwun Tong, they have the lowest monthly income, and there are more elderly people there. In Kowloon East, we have the most rapidly increased population level, and there are the most old elderly citizen there, and they are the poorest. So you see, demand in Kowloon East for public health care service is more acute than other districts. However, the demand is not met. There is an urgent need to improve such service in Kowloon East. We should lose no time. Mr. President, where are the inadequacies in Kowloon East? First, the waiting time for specialist outpatient services is very long. Of course, excessive waiting time is a problem for the entire territory. But according to information of the hospital authority, currently there are four specialists in Kowloon East cluster. For these four specialist area, waiting time is longer than the rest of the territory. Let me show you this. It clearly says that for ophthalmometrics, 135 weeks. So you will have to wait till October 2019. Orthopedics, 120 weeks. So you will have to wait till a very long a very late date. For medicine, 101 weeks. Surgery, 87 weeks. We see these problems in Kowloon East cluster. We have obtained an information on the 8th of March 2017. You see, for geriatrics, you have to wait till March 2019. Adult orthopedics, January 2019. That for your children, March in 2019. Now, I want to talk about Our Lady of Merino Hospital. I use a giraffe because you can wait and wait, and if the longer you wait, your neck will grow, then you'll become a giraffe. For medicine, new cases, November 2019. Orthopedics, May 2020. I only need these two examples to highlight the situation for Our Lady of Mary Knoll Hospital. May 2020 is unbelievable. Compared to other clusters, you have to wait longer. About 3 years, 165 weeks before you get to see the doctor for the first time. I think by the time you get to see the doctor, you will be sick. But that is the problem faced by residents of Kowloon East. A lot of elderly people complain to me that if you want to see a doctor, well, you die before you get there. That is the problem of Kowloon East. And I also want to use two other examples to illustrate my point. In the petitioned area, I heard that in 2016, a person in his 40s would like to get a check of his heart condition. He had to wait till 2019 for a check. The other one is a joint replacement surgery, a wait of 4 years. Colonoscopy, a year or so. And these are few of the many examples in Kowloon East. And that doesn't just apply to specialist outpatient. That's the same for general outpatient services. My first motion, that's why, is to ask for an urgent improvement of public health care services in Kowloon East. We need more resources to shorten the waiting time for specialist outpatient services and general outpatient services. I asked the government to increase manpower to respond to public aspiration so that patients will get medical attention as soon as possible. The second inadequacy. We have no emergency A&E service in Wong Tai Sin. There are three hospitals, but no A&E. 430,000 Wong Tai Sin residents, if they need accident and emergency service, they have to go to a different district. Some will have to go to the United Hospital, some to Kwong Wah, some to United Christian. We've been fighting for it to be addressed for years. If you need accident and emergency service, you can't afford to lose a second. But there are no accident and emergency services in Wong Tai Sin. You will have to go to a different district. That is simply outrageous. That's why the second request I make is to have the 24-hour A&E service in Wong Tai Sin. I have spoken to Ho Hon Man, another district councillor. Someone called for an ambulance in Chi Wan Shan to go to Queen Elizabeth Hospital. But because of traffic congestion, you know how long he's taken? 40 minutes. We really have to tackle this problem. We don't want A&E to be overcrowded, say for example during influenza peak period. In Wong Tai Sin, there should be 24-hour general outpatient services so as to alleviate the pressure on A&E department. Now I move on to Our Lady of Mary Knoll Hospital. Is now of an age of 56 years because it was built in 1969. It is really worn down, leakage on ceiling and the wall, wards. Hospital is where people are saved. They should have state-of-the-art facilities. You can't ask residents of Kowloon East to stay in a hospital that was built over 50 years ago. That's unfair to Wong Tai Sin people. Residents. That's why in my third point, I ask the government to implement the Our Lady of Mary Knoll Hospital redevelopment project. You need to give adequate hospital services to Wong Tai Sin residents. And I want to talk about the United Christian Hospital expansion project for the same reason. Kowloon East residents should have proper hospital services. The expansion project of the United Christian Hospital should be completed as soon as possible. Now I move on to new hospitals. Kai Tak Hospital. According to the hospital authority, between 2013 to 2023, population in Kowloon East will increase by 12% to 1.2 million people. Those over 65 will account for 50%, about 230,000 people. This is a huge demand. Apart from redevelopment of old hospitals, we need commissioning of the Kai Tak Hospital and the Children's Hospital. Apart from shortening waiting time, increasing manpower, redeveloping old hospitals and building new ones, I also want to talk about resource allocation. There are many things that the government can do. Because of an aging population in Kowloon East, and there is an ever-increasing demand of elderly dental services. However, you can only be eligible for the Elderly Dental Assistance Program of the Community Care Fund if you are over 75 years old. I do think that the eligible age should be lowered to 65 so as to align that with the many schemes. And this dental assistance program should be expanded to everyone above the age of 65. This will immediately meet that demand. I am pleased that the government has taken on board DAB's proposal to lower the eligible age of of the elderly healthcare voucher scheme from 75 to 65. This is a good measure because additional healthcare services will be provided to elderly people. This also alleviates pressure on the public sector. However, we're told that $2,000 is not enough and the coverage should be expanded. We ask the government to enhance public-private partnership, and there should be proper monitoring of private organizations under the scheme. I hear from a lot of elderly residents saying that when they use this vouchers, the price seems to be seasonal. If you use vouchers, you'll be charged a higher price. I ask the government to deal with the situation. I have a number of complaints with me. Monitoring the scheme is very important. We hope the elderly healthcare voucher scheme will be effective for every dollar to be properly used. If there are more resources, if the public-private partnership program is enhanced, and if the types of subsidized drugs in the drug formulary is expanded, residents of Kowloon East and the rest of Hong Kong will not have to wait any longer. And I want to make a concluding remark. There is a serious insufficient services in Kowloon East compared to other territories. I can talk about their plight for 3 days on end. I hope the government will do something about the situation after this debate and address the inadequacies in Kowloon East. Give us a timetable, a roadmap. Feel the pulse of residents of Kowloon East, feel our need so that the public healthcare service will be improved. I so submit. Thank you.
I now propose a question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Mr. Wilson all be passed. 6 members will move amendments to this motion. This council will now proceed to a joint debate on the motion and the 6 amendments. I will call upon members who move the amendments to speak in the following order: Mr. HO Kai-ming, Dr. Pierre CHAN, Dr. KWOK, Mr. WU CHI-WAI, Mr. SHIU KA-CHUN, and Mr. LEUNG YIU-CHUNG. But they may not move the amendments at this stage. Mr. Jonathan HO. Thank you, President. On the background of healthcare services in Kowloon East, Mr. Wilson all has covered it, so I won't repeat what he said. And I'd like to talk about the distribution of resources to the Kowloon East sector. As you know, the HA has a mechanism on distributing resources among different clusters. And a number of people, especially doctors who have served for the HA, have pointed out that the distribution of resources among clusters is uneven. And I feel that this uneven balance is due to a lack of consideration by the HA on the population demographics of different regions. I'd like to share some figures. According to the HA's projections, and in 2016, the Kowloon East population is 1.12 million, fourth among all clusters. In terms of elderly population, we have 170,000 elderly people, which is third among all clusters. But how much resources are given to Kowloon East? According to the HA, in 2015 to 16, and the HA reserved 49 billion dollars in total, and Kowloon East only received 5.3 billion, the least among all clusters. And over the years, the KE cluster has received the fewest resources out of all clusters. And there's an uneven distribution of resources, because the amount of resources given to a cluster would affect manpower provision. You need money to hire doctors, nurses, and other workers in hospitals. According to the HA, in 2015 to 16, the number of doctors in KE cluster hospital is 668 for every 10,000 residents. Only six doctors are provided. The territory-wide average is 9 doctors per 10,000 people, and the same applies to nurses and other specialized healthcare offices. And in terms of the manpower ratios, the figures of KE cluster is lowest, and we are lagging behind. And this has affected the quality of healthcare services within the cluster. So even though we have excellent doctors, they can only do so much. And the original motion talked about the waiting times for specialist outpatient services. And the average waiting time for total joint replacement surgery is very long. And according to the HA, the waiting time for total joint replacement surgery is 74 hours, which is more than 6 years. And this is higher than the average figure of the HA at 53 weeks. And why do they insist on carrying out the surgery in public hospitals? If I do it in a private hospital for a kneecap replacement surgery, it would take $180,000. If I perform this surgery in public hospital, I only have to pay $100 per day. And even if I have to stay 2 weeks, I have to spend $1,400 or even or just $700 if I just stay a week. So given the gigantic difference, people would naturally choose public hospitals. So this has reflected the uneven distribution of resources. They have affected healthcare services as well as elderly care services. In my amendment, I suggest the government to put in more resources based on the population characteristics of the cluster in order not to affect healthcare services in the region. And that way we can better prepare for population aging. I also suggest the government to build a joint replacement center in the Kowloon East cluster so we can slash the waiting times for those waiting to receive kneecap replacement surgeries, and that our elderly people can overcome conditions like arthritis. In terms of population aging, I want to point out that the government must pay attention to primary health care, and they should carry out primary health care planning. More primary care facilities should be provided in order to alleviate the burden on hospitals. Kowloon East is full of mountainous areas, and we don't have a lot of space for general hospitals. The government should build more mobile clinics and community healthcare centers to provide one-stop primary care services. These community centers can help divert traffic or patients and reach out to more people through healthcare education and health checks. That way we can reduce the number of patients at source. Dr. Ko, I'm sure a lot of other members have told you that planning is very important. We have a medical center in Yao Tong, and we are about to proceed to the construction of that center. So hopefully you can plan ahead and identify sites. The original motion mentioned some redevelopment and expansion projects, and I support them. But I must say that I'm very concerned about the progress of construction for Kai Tak Hospital. We supported the construction of Kai Tak Hospital because the services provided by the Kowloon clusters is extremely tight, and this hospital can handle the backlog of cases. However, the commissioning targets of the government have been delayed, and it used to be 2020, and subsequently was delayed to 2024. And next to Kai Tak Hospital, we have the Hong Kong Children's Hospital, which will be commissioned soon as well. And the Children's Hospital will be commissioned in 2017. It's a specialist hospital with more than 200 beds, and a lot of services will require support from general hospitals nearby. My concern is, under the current plan, Kai Tak Hospital will only be commissioned in 2024. So in the 6 to 7 years in the meantime, the Children's Hospital will lack support, and they can only provide limited services. And the burden on healthcare services in Kowloon East cannot be relieved. The government should be more proactive in ensuring that Kai Tak Hospital will be commissioned on time, and they should plan for primary healthcare in Kowloon East so that the healthcare services would not lag behind. And this would help with planning for population aging. Thank you.
Dr. Pierre Chan. Mr. President, I have amended Mr. Wilson Orr's motion. I want to use my amendments to make the administration and the government understand that the inadequacies of Kowloon East cluster is not just a district problem. It applies to the entire territory as well. And I would like to draw your attention to three areas. First of all, this motion is to improve public health care services in Kowloon East. I find it logically strange, because most probably this motion will be endorsed. So will other geographically elected members will hold up a banner to say that we have successfully fought for improvement of services in Kowloon East. So what about residents of Kowloon West or New Territories? Next time, it will be changed to urgently improving public healthcare services in Kowloon West, and we repeat the same thing 7 times. That's very strange. Second point, when recurrent allocation remains the same, increasing resources and services to Kowloon East means resources will be taken from other clusters, say NT West. The third point, public health care services in Hong Kong is funded by the government. we will look at how much you have to decide how much you can give. The hospital authority is most worried about uneven distribution. They are not worried about inadequacies. Another point. Well, this is about Kowloon West. However, point six, it says ensuring that the children's hospital will be fully commissioned. Seven, elderly dental assistant program should be expanded to cover those above the age of 65. And number eight, additional services, additional resources to PPP. I agree with that, but I don't know why it comes under this Kowloon East motion. And I have added Haven of Hope Hospital, because this is not just to serve a particular district. We have an aging population, we have an increasing population, that is true. It will drive up demand for public health care. Recurrent allocation of funding has been frozen for a number of years. It's only been increased recently, but it doesn't catch up with inflation. So failure to meet demand is a territory-wide problem. We don't worry about inadequacy, we do worry more about uneven distribution. Legislators have the duty to make sure that the hospital authority will evenly distribute resources. Kowloon East may have more problems, but the HA, Hospital Authority, and the government should focus on the entire territory and not just on Kowloon East. When the member talked about new case waiting time for eye, orthopedic, medicine, surgery, traumatology in Kowloon East is longer than the other clusters. 90% of new cases, of all cases, for orthopedics, medicine, yes, it's long. But for NT West and Kowloon West, it's longer. For NT East, it's longer than the Kowloon East. So is it the case that next time it will be urgently improving public health care services in NT East? And we'll repeat the same thing. What about Obengyn, pediatrics? We have to be concerned with all the different services and on the entire territory. It's not just particular to Kowloon East. I know that votes are very important to you, but long waiting time is an important issue. The announcement of the waiting time is not for you to make political mileage. It's for patients to choose which cluster to go to for your specialist outpatient service. You find the information on the HA hospital. If you find your cluster involves a long waiting time, you can choose to go somewhere else. We will monitor the overall performance of the HA and hold them accountable. If members only focus on their own constituency, the scope will be too narrow. Through my amendment, I hope you will understand that this applies to the entire territory without increasing the overall funding. You draw resources to Kowloon East from other clusters, and the services of other clusters will be affected. That's why I oppose strongly to competing for resources. So I have amended my first point. It should be changed to population-based funding model to shorten waiting time for specialist outpatient service and general outpatient services with a view to benefiting residents of Kowloon East. This is about the entire territory. My second point, I propose to study the introduction of 24-hour general outpatient services in various districts in Hong Kong with a view to benefiting residents of Kowloon East. Well, Queen Elizabeth Hospital and other hospitals in that area offers A&E services. If you have got the service for Wong Tai Sin, but what about Kowloon City? You are a legislator. Your eyes your vision should be wider. Next time, Kowloon West legislator will fight for A&E department in Kowloon West. And usually you find an A&E department in bigger hospitals because an A&E department alone does not suffice. You need supporting facilities, radiology, ICU, and clinical treatment. It's not like a 7-Eleven where you can find one every corner, in every corner. During influenza peak, yes, we hear news about overcrowding in A&E. But the solution lies in increasing outpatient services, especially round-the-clock services. That's why I have changed the point number 2, study the introduction of 24 general outpatient services in various districts with a view to benefiting residents of Kowloon East. This is also in view of even distribution of resources. I do notice that there's been discussion about setting up a dedicated team for Wong Tai Sin. And Kowloon East legislators have asked questions about demand. They asked whether there will be A&E department in Wong Tai Sin Hospital before the commissioning of Kai Tak Hospital. Yes, where possible, when there is a redevelopment project, there can be A&E services added. There should be overall planning for the redevelopment of Our Lady of Mary No Hospital. And I hope that Kai Tak Hospital will be fully commissioned in 2024, serving not just Wong Tai Sin, but nearby districts, say for example Kowloon City. Mr. Jonathan Ho's amendments is also about distribution of resources. Number 10, additional community health centers with one-stop primary healthcare services covering general outpatient, chronic disease, health education. Well, there are 3 community health centers, with the biggest one in Kwun Tong, offering more places every day. There are at least 6 government clinics in Kowloon East, offering general and specialist services. So the supply is not failure to meet the shortage is not more serious than others. Well, if there is a Kowloon East cluster joint replacement center and another one in Wong Tai Sin, I'll find it quite strange. I understand that residents in Kowloon East face a shortage of services. I have taken into account the overall benefits and interest of the entire territory. I ask members to support my amendment.
Dr. KK Kwok, President, I'd like to thank Mr. Wilson all for moving this motion. Mr. Pierre Chan just spoke, and I feel strongly about what he said, because before we discuss Kowloon East, I'd like to talk about the entire territory as well. I believe we need to improve all healthcare services in Hong Kong. Of course, I would agree that in Kowloon East, there is this big structural problem. In Kowloon East, even today, there is only one leading hospital, and that is United Christian. And because of its history, it was a subvented hospital. After all these years, the HA has been operating it, and hopefully it can be at a par with other lead hospitals, but I don't think it has achieved that even today. And secondly, the elderly population in Kowloon East is also very high, even amongst the different clusters. In Wong Tai Sin and Kwun Tong, they take up the second and third largest elderly population. Those over 65 take up 17.4% of the population and 17.3% for Kwun Tong, which is higher than the territorial average of about 14%. Out of the 430,000 people in Wong Tai Sin, 85% live in public housing, and 70% of people in Kun Tong live in public housing. Plus, in Kun Tong, Choi Ying, Choi Fook, Choi Tech estates have just taken in population, and there will also be Anderson Quarry site development. All that will put pressure on medical services, and because of the income level and because of people's background, there would be problems with healthcare services in Kowloon East. But before we talk about Kowloon East, let us talk about overall healthcare services for Hong Kong. It's quite an alarming situation. From 2014, when we had 7.23 million people, by 2041, there would be 8.47 million. And the elderly population will rise from the present 14.8% to 30%. And the HA figures show that those who are over 65 and those who need acute beds, that is 8 times more than the people who are under 65. That is why all these years, throughout the territory, there has been a shortage of hospital beds. I agree that Dr. Koh has been more aggressive than the previous secretary. That is true. I don't know whether the secretary will remain in post or be promoted in the next term government, but I'd like to thank Dr. Koh for doing your best to increase public hospital beds in your term. And that is a fair statement. But is it enough? The figures will tell the truth. In 1997, the number of beds, it's 4.2 per 1,000 population. In 2007, it is 4 per 1,000. And 2015, it is 3.8 per 1,000 population. So the proportion is falling, but the elderly population is rising. If we use a weighted figure, in other words, including beds needed by the elderly, well, Secretary, you can let us know the details, but we use $200 billion to increase beds by 5,000, but there will still be a shortage of 10,000 beds because people over 65 would need hospital beds, but then we cannot compare that with those people under 65. They also need different services. That is why we hope the administration will respond. But unfortunately, the overall response is disappointing. In 2014-2015, the medical expenses took up 17% of overall expenditure. That was promised by the last term of government, that is by Donald Zhang, but then it only reached 17% in 2015, and then it dropped to 16.8%, and then 16.5%, and this year, the administration is really smart. You know how to do your sums. You say you would add 2 billion more, so it goes back to 17%. And 17% is just the figure for 5 years ago. When there is an increased population, when there are more medical needs, we of course need more funding. But we have only marked time. I can think of a story that I can tell you. It should be 17%. But then it went down from 16.8% to 16.5%, and now it goes back to 17%. So it seems we should be happy. It's like some heavenly endowment. And the hospital authority should be kowtowing to you to thank you. Please don't play these games because it's unfair. There is a structural problem, and that is the cluster system within the hospital authority. When the secretary said there would be a reform to the hospital authority structure vis-a-vis the clusters, I had some hope in you, but last year, you released a report which was unacceptable. Kowloon West and Kowloon Central were delineated again, and you now relax or make it easier for people to seek medical attention across the clusters. But that's it, and nothing else. when the hospital authority is asked to provide some non-crucial services, you should adopt policies and methods so that there would be less pressure on specialist services in the hospital authority, so people can take care of patients who are in need. As you know, people go back to get medication for orthopedics and surgical and medical wards. I am disappointed not just about services in Kowloon East, but 5 years down the road, we have got $200 billion. You know, the one who made the promise had left his post. We don't know whether the new CE would adopt his approach. I hope there will not be political persecution and that the former proposals would all be wiped out. Well, even so, I'd like to make a few requests in this debate. In Kowloon East, the psychiatric services has a very poor manpower ratio and the services are inadequate. I'd like to take this opportunity to ask for nighttime service because many people are working. They don't want people to know that they have to seek psychiatric attention. So the nighttime service will be able to help them remove the label, the labeling effect. And secondly, elderly service center and also women's service center and also maternal and child health centers, all those are inadequate. There is only one woman health center in Lamtin and people have to depend on maternal and child care health services. But they are providing different kinds of services. And as you know, grassroots women cannot go to a private doctor. They rely on women health centers to give them fundamental assistance. But you have only marked time all these years in this respect. And the same goes for elderly health centers. And then public dental services. I think the secretary knows that the disadvantaged and the mentally disabled, they have petitioned to you. And also the low-income group, elderly people and grassroots families, they have no ability to take care of their teeth. I have put this in, but I don't know when you will respond. Last but not least, GOPC. It has been on the drawing board for a long time. Last term, Dr. Koh, this was not proposed to help the public, but you just took away the people who could line up at 5 a.m., 6 a.m. And secondly, it has become more difficult to seek GOPC attention. There is no line that can be formed and you cannot get through on telephone. So either you don't seek attention or you go to a private doctor. Last but not least, this kind of poor administration will be responded to by the secretary, and please resolve it in your term. Thank you.
WU Chi-wai.
Mr. WU Chi-wai. Today we are discussing the urgent improvement to public health care services in Kowloon East. And there have been descriptions which do not fit the situation at Kowloon East because the KE cluster also includes Chiang Kwan O. So for the watching audience, I want to clarify a few things. Kowloon East includes Wong Tai Sin and Kun Tong, and they belong to the Kowloon Central and Kowloon East clusters respectively. In terms of the service population for Central Kowloon, the population is 1.18 million. And there are 4,856 beds, and for Kowloon East, the population is 1.1 million, and they have 2,527 general hospital beds. For Kun Tong and the Kowloon East cluster, we can see that there's a lack of resources. According to the HA, force, and for the waiting time for stable new case bookings for KE, for ICE, it's 135 weeks, and for Central Kowloon, it's 87 weeks. So 135 weeks is equivalent to more than 2 years. This is really pathetic as well as disappointing. And this shows the shortage of public health care services. I understand that DHA has come up with ways to allow cross-region lines, but it just shows that the demand for healthcare is enormous. According to the 2016 population by census, and the two clusters contain the high percentage of those age 65 or above at 17.2%. And we have been talking about expansion of hospitals and increase of services, and we support these motions.
Now I'd like to focus on the amendments from the DP, including expansion of the Lady of the Magnihos Marinor Hospital. We want the expansion to allow the hospital to provide 24-hour outpatient services so that light cases can be tackled around the clock to lower the burden on the A&E departments of nearby. Now, the night clinic ends at 10 or 8 p.m. In fact, there are two or three doctors on call, so if there can be 24-hour clinic services, then with the addition of a small amount of manpower, that would be possible without creating undue pressure on the financial aspect. This will alleviate the burden on other A&E departments. Before 2002, overnight outpatient services were always available and was only abolished after 2002. So patients have to go to a QEH or UCH for A&E services overnight. Of course, HA has recently increased the charge of A&E departments to $220 to prevent abuse. However, the administration increased night OPD and overnight OPD services. Otherwise, if you just rely on increase in fees and charges, you cannot address the urgent need for clinic services. We're also concerned about the need for dental services among the elderly. Poor dental health could affect their social life and could affect their eating and nutrition, affecting their health in turn. In 2011, according to a survey on oral and dental health, there is a need for improvement of services in this regard for the elderly in particular. We've asked the administration to make reference of the General Outpatient Clinic Public-Private Partnership Program so that the elderly could be subsidized for a dental checkup on an annual basis, and there should be dental clinics in all hospitals in Hong Kong so that filling and crowning and scaling services can be provided. Most of the dental services in the public sector are for civil servants. They haven't been expanded to cover the dental needs of the general public, and therefore the administration should consider this. Dental services is an important area of primary care, and we should start to work on this. In 2014, there is the outreaching service, dental services for elderly persons living in RCHEs and daycare centers, free of charge. This scheme would end on the 30th of September this year. DP hopes that in his response, the secretary will tell us what will happen to this service, because it is a very important dental health service for the elderly, and we want it to continue. We should also develop primary health care, and dental services is an important element. Prevention is always better than cure. In 2010, a strategic document was published by the Bureau. To improve public health, we need to reduce the risk for the public to contract chronic diseases and complications of chronic diseases.
To achieve this, we need a concerted effort in society. We should promote healthy habits to lower the risk of getting sick. And there should be early detection and provide quality health care to lower the possibility of complications and to lower death rate in the long term. We should have a seed fund to subsidize the public to undergo regular physical checkups. Ordinary diseases like high blood pressure and DM, if they are detected earlier, we can greatly lower the associated healthcare costs subsequently. I asked an oral question on colon cancer and rectal cancer. Time for waiting for a general screening gets longer and longer. With this trend for younger people to catch this disease or this cancer, we should subsidize members of the public to have checkup and do an endoscope in private hospitals. Currently, the screening coverage is relatively low. I suggested we enhance the level of subsidy and the scope of those eligible so that we can have sufficient resources to tackle the trend of people contracting this cancer younger. And we should use the public-private sector private partnership program to achieve early prevention. However, the reply from the administration is very disappointing. It is said that the high-risk persons not subject to the current screening will not be covered. And the secretary advised the high-risk persons to go to hospitals for early checking. In fact, those eligible should be able to seek help under the public-private partnership program. If this is the attitude of the administration, we cannot have any prevention. I hope that the secretary in his reply can tell us what strategies he has to promote prevention rather than cure, so that promotion of primary care can be more comprehensive and widespread, so that our healthcare expenses can be spent on areas in urgent need. And healthcare service is about manpower planning. We've got a 10-year blueprint for hospital development, but for manpower planning hospital services, we have not heard anything concrete. We've been given a paper that by 2020, HA will be 400 and 300 doctors short, respectively. That is in 2016 and 2020. That is after the we know that there will be a strategic review of professionals associated with hospital services. I urge the administration to start the review ASAP and to give us a report so that we can address the ever-rising demand for hospital or healthcare needs in this community. Thank you.
Mr. SHIU Ka-chun. Thank you, President. I'd like to thank Mr. Wilson Orr for moving this motion to improve the healthcare services in Kowloon East so that we can have an opportunity to discuss the direction to which healthcare services should be heading. Should we be heading towards the private sector or the public health sector? For me, well, we should not look at the technical side of the social policy. We should look at the kind of society that we want to build, what kind of social relations that we want to see, what are kind of social values that we want to put in place. But then social policies have flaws, and we are providing individual service to those in need, and those with vested interests will benefit. And we have dodged the responsibility of having social policies to build a fair society now. I'd like to talk about privatization. What do we mean by privatization? A UK sociologist, Professor Walker, gave us a very clean, simple definition. When the social services, the responsibility are devolved to the private sector, and we bring in the commercial principles,
in which profits are pursued. So if these are the standards adopted to distribute the resources, then these social services are being privatized. We have set up the HA, and in fact, we are privatizing the healthcare services. The government has lessened its responsibility in providing healthcare services. In terms of appointment, in terms of funding, the government can still have a control. But in effect, what we are seeing is that the HA is taking up all the responsibility. The HA has become the buffer zone for the government in providing healthcare services. Recently, the HA has emphasized that they would try to narrow the discrepancy in their charges between them and the private sector. They want to narrow that gap. They want to recover cost. And what they are doing is that they are not giving any thought to the affordability of the public, the protection afforded to the public, but they are emphasizing the patient's affordability. The users' fees become a major source of their income. Recently, the HA, in terms of GOPC, ANE, and SOPC, have proposed a fee increase. They want to recover the cost. Also, the government refuses to do financing for public services. We have discussions indefinitely, and now we are having this voluntary healthcare insurance plan, and it is encouraging the public to buy our private insurance, and they should take their own responsibility. They are turning a blind eye to the wealth gap, and ultimately, the healthcare service needs in the community is being met by the private market. And they try to readjust the ratio between the private and public services so that they can lessen the burden of the public healthcare system. So as a result, rich people can get better and more services, but the poor people can only use the poorer services. The basic problem in our system is that we lack resources. The government's expenditure on healthcare services takes up only 5% of the GDP. That is the 2014 figure. Compared to the US and Europe, 10%, South Korea, 7.4%, Taiwan, 6.2%. It's much less. We are lacking resources seriously. So in that case, the system is subject to criticisms. We are privatizing the public healthcare system. They want to do it to lessen their pressure. They want to dodge their responsibility. And as a result, Hong Kong people, because of the privatization, are enjoying less healthcare services. Now, responding to Mr. Wilson Orr's motion, I generally agree with his motion, but there are a few points that need clarification. First, as what Dr. Pierre Chan wrote in his letter to all, if Hong Kong's public health care system is a zero-sum game, in other words, if we are to improve the Kowloon East system, then the resources in other districts will be cut. Then I can't agree with Mr. Orr's motion. I don't agree that this should be the improvement measure should be turned into competition among the different clusters. So I have added this in my motion, and that is we should make financing and planning for public healthcare services. We can't just depend on the taxation as a source of revenue for our healthcare system. Only by doing that, we can improve the healthcare services in the long term, including that in Kowloon East. And I don't agree with Mr. Wilson Orr's motion that the additional resources should be allocated to the enhanced PPP. I think that will only be, again, an excuse for the government to stop improving on public healthcare system. You are pushing the patients to the private health market. And I hope that the government can improve and strengthen the GOPC services in the public healthcare system and the SOPC services. And enhancing PPP goes against what I agree. So sorry, I can't support that. If we privatize the public healthcare system, we will not be able to improve the quality. And conversely, the poor people cannot get the services they need. And that will be inequality and division in the society as a result. Third, I agree that the government must shorten the waiting list of the waiting time of the GOPC, SOPC. The way to do it is to strengthen the services. I suggest the government provide evening consultation services, and also at the GOPC, there should be 24-hour services. They should be able to meet the needs of members of the public, and also lessen the pressure on A&E department. And we also need to strengthen psychiatric SOPC. We need to introduce evening consultation services so that they can meet the need of those in rehabilitation who have to work. Now, we have to try to treat people when they are at the early stage of the disease. We have inadequate resources, but there is also mismatching in the resources. The HA devotes a lot of resources to SOPCs, but for primary health care and also disease prevention, the resources are inadequate. Primary health care services is dominated by the private sector. So I agree that in the medium and long term, the government and the HA must devote more resources to enhance primary health care and disease prevention services. Hong Kong's healthcare system, the crux of the problem is that the public healthcare system suffers from a heavy burden, but while we are seeing high charges in the private sector, and the low-income earners can't afford the private healthcare services, and without any choices, they have to wait for a long time for the public healthcare services. As a result, well, there is a supply outstripping the demand all the time, and because of the aging population and also rising costs, the government is just privatizing the services. It is strategy, the only strategy, and they want to push people to the private market. It refuses to use the public policy to redistribute wealth and try to narrow down the wealth gap, and it's shirking its responsibility. So this is a crux of the problem in our public healthcare system. President, I said that the social policies are not about money or about what works best. The crux or the key word is society in any social policies. Our healthcare services are social services. Policies, what do we want to be seeing in a society? What kind of society that we want to build? Are we seeing rich people getting richer, poor people getting poorer? Or should we be building this caring society? So that kind of principle straddles across all different policies. I think I would like to say that social policies are about social relationships and social care for people. Thank you.
Mr. Leung Yiu-chung. President, I must emphasize that in Kowloon East cluster, the resources are in short supply, but this is not a problem peculiar to Kowloon East alone. The major problem with our healthcare system is, like other members said, that the supply fails to catch up with demand. Hong Kong is suffering from an aging population, which is getting worse. Those above 65, it is 1.7 billion or 16.6%. In terms of proportion, in 2034, the proportion is going to go up to 34%. And as a result, the demand for hospital service would be ever greater, and the occupancy rate is almost 90%. In A&E hospitals, the occupancy rate is 120% at peak period, in particular Kowloon East, Kowloon West, and NT East, and the situation is particularly acute. The most direct solution is to increase resources. But like my fellow colleague said, the expenditure is less than 6%, of GDP, lower than Korea, Japan, and other European countries. The government gave the undertaking that in 2012 or before that, the expenditure will be raised to 17% of the GDP. But as of now, it is hovering around 16.7%.
The government simply fails to achieve the target. This causes a situation where the healthcare resources fail to catch up with the demand, and this is wholly disappointing. In terms of healthcare policy, like my colleague said, at least there are problems that cannot be exhausted in our debate for 3 days. I would like, however, to concentrate on 3 areas. The first one is the community dental service. The second one is the PPP system, and also psychiatric service. And these are the areas that many expressed difficulties with. First, dental care. The dental service in Hong Kong is grossly inadequate. In 18 districts, there are only 11 dental clinics providing acute dental service, and they're not evenly distributed. One of them is in the NT. Many of the patients who have to cross the district for dental care. According to our statistics, half of the patients patronizing these dental clinics are elderly people, but with aging population, the situation is getting worse. The quota has not been increased. In Kowloon, for instance, which takes up 30% of the total population, Kowloon East is suffering from the worst aging problem, and the aging population will only increase further. There are only 2 dental clinics. For Kowloon as a whole, on a weekly basis, there are less than 200 attendances that would be available to the patients. Many senior citizens would have an option but to line up at the crack of dawn. They're not sure whether they will be able to get a quota. If they don't get a quota, and then they have to come back again the following week. Many of the dental clinics are not open every day. They may be open a couple of days a week for only half a day if they open at all. So even if they queue up at the crack of dawn, they are not able to get to make it into the clinic. Now, these dental clinics, they're not doing much. They would just disinfect your teeth if you're suffering from toothache, or if they may do tooth extraction. Otherwise, you have to go to the private dentists. For the private sector, dentists are particularly expensive. It would be unaffordable to the general public, and they have no option but to patronize the public service, which is heavily limited. So this is indeed a very serious problem. So we hope that the administration should devote more resources in this regard. The government always comes up with the excuse that if they devote more resources, there will be no limit to it, because the resources would be considerable, and they will not be able to pay their way out of the problem. And they also said that it's not as if they don't have any subsidy. Dental care would mean a great deal. If someone is suffering from dental problems, they cannot eat, that would be debilitating to their health, and it's not good for the administration either, because it would generate more healthcare needs, and the social capital would only creep up as a result. I hope that the administration would do more and devote more resources to this and increase the number of clinics and site them in every district. The government should cover filling, crowning, and scaling, and all the rest of the dental care for the members of the public. The other thing I'd like to mention is the drug formulary. I have received a lot of feedback from the patients or patients' organizations. They said that there are certain the illnesses that require specialized drugs, which are prohibitively expensive. and they can only balk at the drugs because they cannot afford them. So it is very worrying for these people. Now for these rare illnesses, they do need a specialized medicine for them to be cured. Unfortunately, many of these drugs are not in the drug formulary. Now we may have the CCF or the Samaritan's Fund, but many of them are not eligible for them. These are chronic illnesses. They need the drugs for many, many doses, and it costs them more than $10,000 per dose, and it would be prohibitively expensive for them. I hope that many of these drugs can be incorporated into the drug formulary to for them to sustain their life. Dr. Ko, the patients' organizations would like to meet you and tell you about the situation. Now, for 2 years, we've been writing to the HFB, we've been emailing the HFB, but we drew a blank, and your colleagues are not willing to meet the patients. It is very regrettable for this to happen. I do hope that you would take time out of your schedule. You may not be able to solve all their problems, but I mean, just meeting them would be therapeutic. It would be good for them. You don't even want to do that. And this is wholly regretful. For these drugs, you have very high requirements, like multiple sclerosis. Now, there is a kind of drug which is very important for them. And these people would have to take 100 steps before they would be able to get this kind of drug. And it is terribly difficult for them. And they cannot get access to this kind of drug, and this is filling them with a lot of worries. So I think the government should speed up the approval of the subsidized drugs and allow patients' representatives to be sitting on the approving committee. Long story short, for PPP, the public sector is suffering from a manpower shortage. It is on the right to increase public-private partnership. The government should lower the fees and charges and make sure that they are affordable. Now, for those who are referred to the private clinics, they should be allowed to return to the public hospital for continued treatment where necessary. In the long run, the government should increase the resources to meet the needs, and the resources should be evenly distributed among the different clusters. I hope that the government would heed our voices and make the adjustment accordingly. SFH. Madam Deputy, first of all, I'm grateful to Mr. Wilson Orr for moving this motion. In this part of my speech, I would outline the overall situation and the work that we have undertaken regarding the public health services in Kowloon East Cluster. And thereafter, I'll be listening to members' views and make a response later on. Hong Kong is suffering from the challenge of an aging population, and Kowloon East is no exception. In 2015, those above 65, they take up 18.5% of the total population in Kwun Tong and Mong Tai Sin, and this is going to go up to 23% in 2014. And compared with the whole of Hong Kong, the elderly population in Kowloon East is 2.7% higher. So given the ever-increasing demand, we have been increasing the resources. Over the past 4 years, we have increased 172 acute and convalescent beds. And in this financial year, we're going to be increasing 58 acute and convalescent beds in Kowloon East. Now, we have launched a number of measures like the dialysis service for the renal patients. We have increased endoscopy sessions. In 2017-18, we provide 24-hour intravenous thrombolytic therapy for ischemic stroke patients. For outpatient clinics, we have four GOPC or SOPC and eight GOPCs. In Zhengguanluo, there is nighttime service. At the Guntong Community Health Clinic, we do provide nighttime and service and services over the public holidays. In the cluster, we have also increased the outpatient service for the episodic disease sufferers. In the Kowloon East cluster, we work together with family medicine and orthopedics to increase the number of patients that they will be looked after. As to rehabilitation, the Kowloon East cluster provides rehab services for stroke patients, lower limb fracture patients, as well as arthroplasty patients. And these services will be extended to weekends and public holidays. In 2018, there will be extra attendance of 1,150 physiotherapy sessions, and they will be assisted by the coordinators. In 2017-18, we would increase the medicine social collaboration service, and we make preparation for the discharge of elderly patients. For clinical service in Kowloon East, we have stepped up the lab test for cancer patients to make sure the quality of service and is good enough. In 2017-18, we have stepped up the service. For instance, we have 165 molecular detection services for lung cancer patients. We provide 575 vision tests for glaucoma patients, and we stepped up the lab test for TB diagnosis. We've also increased the psychiatric service for children and young people. We bring in the cross-disciplinary team, and we have introduced the ex-mental patients to act as peer support for the mental patients. In the coming year, in Kowloon East cluster, we will step up the peer support and also step up the hospital service and clinical psychology service. In 2014, the hospital authority has launched the GOPC PPP program for Wong Tai Sin, Kwun Tong, and Tuen Mun, so that the patients suffering from hypertension, diabetes, in stable condition, can choose the family physician in the scheme as their doctors. And the quota set aside will be made available to other needy patients to meet the demand. As of February this year, in Wong Tai Sin and Kwun Tong, 5,507 patients have joined the scheme. The HA will continue with communication with the stakeholders to monitor the situation. And UCH and Haven of Hope hospitals are undergoing redevelopment to upgrade the service to meet the demand. We have the 10-year hospital development program, and this includes the acute general hospital in Kai Tak and redevelopment of Our Lady of Merino Hospital. The children's hospital in Kai Tak, upon completion, will further upgrade the pediatric service in Hong Kong. Madam Deputy, I've outlined the overall situation for Kowloon East cluster. Having listened to members' views, I'll be going into greater detail about the latest development of the service and also all the improvement measures. Thank you.
Mr. Lam Chuk Ting. Madam Deputy, Mr. Wilson's motion is to improve the healthcare services for Kowloon East. The DP supports this motion and all the amendments. However, the problems are not unique to Kowloon East. I'm from the North District, and there are many problems associated with healthcare services in the North District. According to the HA, Hong Kong is severely short of doctors. Take the North District as an example. Although many doctors are willing to work overtime to help out in other hospitals and even hospitals in the East, but then doctors tend not to choose to work in remote hospitals in our district. As a result, the doctor shortage is particularly acute in my district. So I think this problem is not unique to the North District. Perhaps Kowloon East faces a similar problem. Why do we have such an acute shortage of doctors? Let's take a look at some figures. Before the handover, doctors train in Commonwealth places after they have got practicing qualifications could come and practice in Hong Kong. However, it's been more difficult after the handover. For those who have passed the licensing examination before, we had 49 licenses issued per year on average. After the handover, it's just 9.7 licenses per year. And the passing rate prior to the handover, now there are three examinations, including professional knowledge, a medical English, and a clinical test. You have to pass all three. Prior to the handover, the passing rate was 6.6%, and it dropped drastically to 3.6% after the handover. These licensing examination has been heavily criticized by doctors trained overseas. They're of the view that the examination is too difficult. For instance, they gave me an example. One of the tests question was occupational and safety legislation in Hong Kong, and they were not trained on that overseas, so they faced great difficulties. And some medical doctors complained to me that they were only informed of a licensing examination date a few days prior to the actual sitting. So when they're overseas, they have to buy a ticket, fly back to Hong Kong, and they haven't recovered from jet lag when they actually go for the examination. So the arrangements are very unreasonable. These candidates doubt whether the license examination is so arranged to make them to give them a hard time so that they cannot practice in Hong Kong easily. We may have our own children trained and qualified overseas and in Commonwealth countries. Why can't they come back to practice in Hong Kong so that we can have an increased supply of doctors, so that the Kowloon East cluster and all other clusters will see an increase in supply of doctors? As said, for the waiting time for many healthcare services is getting longer and longer. For specialist services, you may have to wait easily for 1 to 2 years. My daughter had an accident in school not long ago. She had to attend an A&E department. I stayed with her. We waited for 3 hours. After 3 hours, the more and more acute cases came in the interim, so we gave up. Unfortunately, I'm not Mr. Tam. I could not go for a fast track, and many residents in Hong Kong are used to wait for hours after hours. It can be a half day or 1 day at A&E departments. Specialist services, we talk about a matter of months. So this is causing medical problems to aggravate, to worsen. So a minor illness may become a major disease. So may I appeal to the government and the medical sector, please review the arrangement of license examination for doctors in Hong Kong. Are the arrangements not convenient enough for overseas candidates? Are the questions too harsh? I agree that we cannot compromise when it comes to the quality of doctors, but the arrangements should at least be reasonable. We say that some doctors are from Mars. Some can easily make $1 million per month, or some even $1 million in a week. I don't know how come they can make so much money. Perhaps they are particularly skillful. Now, if they can make so much money because their medical skills are so high, it doesn't matter. Hong Kong has a free economy. But if it is because of protectionism that we're controlling the supply of doctors so that we don't have enough to go around or to meet the great demand from the community so that they can profiteer, this is undermining our public interest. Madam Deputy, we are talking about public health care services in Hong Kong, and they account for a very big market share in Hong Kong. So whether it be the HA or the government or the business, I mean the medical sector, please do listen to the grievances of the community and also young people who are trained and qualified overseas. Do allow them to come back to practice. Thank you. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you, Madam Deputy. First, I want to thank Mr. Wilson Oh for his motion to urgently improve public health care services in Kowloon East. BP and I myself agree to the essence of his motion. In fact, BPA has urged the administration time again to increase resources and to enhance public-private partnership so as to enhance our quality of medical services. Mr. Chiu Ka-chun, in his motion, deleted the last part of the motion, allocating additional resources to enhance the public-private partnership program in healthcare. This is baffling. The public have high expectations. We want more services, and this is not restricted to the Kowloon East cluster. Let me declare I'm a member of the HA board, but there is no pecuniary interest involved. Members of the whole community have great aspirations for improved healthcare services. So I think we should look at it from on a territory-wide basis, and the administration should improve the overall level of public healthcare services in Hong Kong, and those in Kowloon East are bound to benefit as well. In fact, we have put in a lot of resources into the sector. In 2007-08, recurring expenditure on public health care amounted to $61.9 billion, or 70% of total government expenditure recurrently. And $2 billion were given to HA to increase the number of beds and various diagnostic places. The government has announced a 10-year HDP amounting to $200 billion. At Kai Tak, there will be a new acute hospital, acute general hospitals, and the development plan will involve 10 hospitals in Hong Kong. Resources were put in are tremendous, yet the services are still not up to the expectation of the public, because the allocation of resources has yet to be improved. And some hospital expansion projects are still in the drawing board. And therefore, the government must consult all stakeholders and consult widely to find out the problems of our healthcare, public healthcare sector, so that we have short, long, medium, and long-term measures to tackle the problems at their root. There should be improvement in the allocation of resources so that we can have immediate improvement to our public healthcare sector. We should shorten the waiting time for general outpatient clinic and specialist clinic services for all elderly persons and those who are that suffer from mobility problems can be given better services, and there should be improved information to the public, and we should also quickly improve the drug formulary system. In the medium term, the government should secure the support of different sectors so that various public works projects for expansion and redevelopment hospitals can start. For instance, redevelopment of the Lady of the Merino Hospital and also the Kai Tak Hospital. I hope that by 2024 they can be commissioned. In his policy address 2017, the CE decided to reserve money and land for construction of Chinese medical hospital in Chang Kwan O. I believe this and the next time government would want to follow up on this proposal. We must face up to the fact that our population is aging, and we must have a comprehensive medical policy to plan for the resources required for our future population. We've started the 2030 plus planning study. I'm of the view that long-term land use must have regard, must give regard to livelihood and economic needs. We should have economic development, and we must reserve land for various healthcare and rehabilitation facilities. We must implement various hospital expansion and development plans. And the government must address the shortage of healthcare manpower shortage. There should be resources to ensure stable supply of manpower, and there should be plans to enhance the quality of our healthcare personnel in the long term. To alleviate the pressure on our public healthcare sector, there should be various measures. We should expedite the review of support and coordination among hospitals in different clusters. We should promote public-private partnership. For instance, we have this e-healthcare record sharing system. It was launched in March last year for phase one, and we should continue to work on this and encourage participation of medical personnel. BPA has suggested to the government a number of times that in the long term, we must implement the voluntary medical insurance scheme, and a tax rebate should be given to encourage those who need it take out health insurance so that they can make use of private resources and to lessen the burden on our public healthcare sector. The amendments cover a number of specific measures, showing that members from different political parties are very pragmatic and our views are rather unanimous. So on livelihood matters, we can really cooperate, negotiate, and come to a consensus. I hope this will set a new trend for cooperation in this council. Thank you.
Mr. Chen Hanpan, Madam Deputy, earlier this year, the Kowloon Hospital and the United Christian Hospital, there were cases of sexual assault of the patients. And this has sounded a warning to our psychiatric services earlier on. I have also visited the Taipo Hospital. Is an acute psychiatric service. The ward situation is very congested. The ward is filled with has 18 beds, and there is a distance of less than 1 foot between the two beds, and a couple of beds were placed on the corridors. And I asked, will the patients fight against each other because the situation was so cramped? They said, yes, they were agitated because of the congestion. And then I asked, how come that you would not make open the ward at the back? Well, they said that in the evening shift, there was one nurse and one assistant who was taking care of 50 to 60 patients. And then if anything untoward's happening, then they may not be able to take care of it. and I've looked at the population statistics. After 2003, Taipo Hospital, well, there was no increase in the number of beds. But then the population from 2003 up to now, there has been a big increase. NT East, 1.45 million in 2003. Now is 1.8 million. So we have an increase of some 300,000 people. But for NT East, the number of psychiatric beds has not increased at all. So you can see, you can imagine how serious the problem gets. The Alliance for Promoting Mental Health has done a survey on the satisfaction of psychiatric services. The respondents were very dissatisfied about the hygiene condition in psychiatric wards. Those respondents said they felt that they were not being respected. And this has to do with the acute shortage in healthcare staff. According to WHO standards, for 10,000 people, there should be one psychiatrist. But in Hong Kong, we have 7 million in our population. We should have 700 psychiatrists. But in 2014, the number in HA, well, was just 330. Psychiatric nurses, only 2,400. The Hong Kong Nursing Association's survey, well, 100% of the nurses said that the SOPC in psychiatric services and also the daycare center were seriously understaffed, and the waiting time problem is very serious. The inadequate manpower in psychiatric services is reflected in the waiting time. In Kowloon East, the problem is mostly serious. Most of the clusters have a waiting time of 3 or so weeks for first consultation. But for Kowloon East, for semi-urgent new cases, the waiting time is 5 weeks. Stable new cases, 96 weeks is the waiting time. In other words, 2 years. In 2014, there was this patient who suffered from depression because of the long waiting time. And during the waiting time, he jumped to his death. So this goes to show that psychiatric patients are not cared for properly, and the problem is serious. Community rehabilitation services come with inadequate resources. The government has been encouraging mental patients to use community resources and integrate into the society. But then HA was making use of the opportunity to cut down the number of psychiatric beds. In 2016 compared to 2003, well, there was 1,000 less psychiatric beds. Take Taipo Hospital as an example. They have so many patients. I've asked the doctors, what happens if the beds are all occupied? The doctor said that, well, if they look a little bit more stable, then they would be discharged. But then after a few days later, they would have to be admitted again. So the problem is really serious. And the HA has also, as case management support scheme, at the district level, there is a case manager taking care of mental patients in the community. The principle is 1 to 50. But then, according to overseas standards, it should be 1 to 20. So we have this standard of 1 to 50. Our ratio is higher. But then most case managers are following up 60 or 80 patients. So they may not visit the patient even once every month. And because they have to deal with so many cases, and they have difficulties in recalling some of the names of the patients. So we suggest that the government should hire more psychiatrists and slash the waiting time, and also enhance training for nurses, especially psychiatric nurses. You should promote the case manager service and provide more resources. And what's most important, they should be redeveloping or aged psychiatric hospitals and psychiatric wards. Dr. Koh, you've been working very hard. You have try to redevelop a number of hospitals. But this is a long-term work, I believe. And I hope that Dr. Ko, well, we hope that you can stay for the next term. If you do that, I hope that you can help promote more redevelopment plans for hospitals so that we can do the best job in our provision of healthcare services. Ms. Dory Lee. President, today Mr. Wilson moved this motion. He used the word urgently improving public healthcare services in Kowloon East. I think he used the right words. Let me give you some figures to explain why Kowloon East residents have an urgent need to improve public healthcare services. Kowloon East cover Kun Tong and Wong Tai Shin. In the 2011 population census, there are over 620,000 in Kun Tong and Wong Tai Shin, 420,000, over 1 million in total for the two. So taking up 1/7 of the total population in Hong Kong, those aged over 65, in terms of their ratio, in Wong Tai Shin, there are 70,000. The ratio is 17.6%, the highest in Hong Kong. In Kun Tong, there are over 100,000, 16.3%, ranking third of the whole of Hong Kong. And the Kowloon East has a lot of grassrooters. They have a lot of housing estates. Going by the statistics in Kun Tong, those who have an income of less than $10,000, 42.3%. In Wong Tai Shin, the ratio is 42.7%. If you look at the median household income, the situation is also very clear. In Kun Tong, it houses the most number of grassrooters. The median monthly household income is 15,000, and Wong Tai Shin ranks third. And the median household income is only 17,000. So they are lower than the average of 20,500 for Hong Kong. So we have a large elderly population. A number of grassrooters. So naturally, there is an urgent need for public health care services in the district. In face of these demographic characteristics, Mr. Chan Pan said that the secretary has been working hard to redevelop the public hospitals, but then Kowloon East residents said that you have not been facing up to their problems and meeting their medical needs. In fact, when I visited Kowloon East every time, the grassrooters, especially the elderly people, told me that they were not getting appropriate healthcare services. And those who came for the petition today, they told me that this particular person said that he was checking on his heart situation and his heartbeat is below 40. And then the date for the next consultation is 2019. Of course, I have to respect the clinical judgment of the doctor, but then the residents may feel that it's because the service is inadequate as a result. The waiting time or the consultation time has to be pushed back to such a late date. The Kowloon East residents think that the services are really outrageous. The first thing, well, there are so many clusters in the HA and the resources are not distributed evenly. Kowloon East takes up 14% of the entire population in Hong Kong, but then they are getting 10% of in their expending. In terms of the population ratio, the patient number, and the usage of A&E ward, well, the usage level is higher than other clusters, say, for example, the Hong Kong East cluster. And it is, however, getting only half of the resources for Hong Kong East. And there, in Kowloon East, there is only one acute hospital providing A&E services, that is the United Christian Hospital. There are two districts in Kowloon East, Wong Tai Shin and Kun Tong. We have a population of 1 million people and elderly 170,000 people. Wong Tai Shin, residents have been complaining to me incessantly. They complain that there is no hospital providing A&E service in that district. There are three hospitals in Wong Tai Shin, that's true, but every time when there is urgent need, then they have to go across the district. According to statistics, over 50% will be sent to the QEH, 25% to Kwong Wah Hospital, and the rest to UCH. You know that, well, the traffic situation in Kowloon is very, very busy. If there is congestion, then there may be delays in sending the patients to the hospitals. And people's life may be at risk. And the third outrageous thing is the hospitals in Wong Tai Shin, according to information, are not serving mainly the Wong Tai Shin residents. There are three hospitals in Wong Tai Shin, Wong Tai Shin Hospital, OLMH, and the Buddhist Hospital. They are really convalescent hospitals. They provide GOPC rehabilitation services, very limited SOPC services. In 2012 study, it is shown that there are some ironic phenomena. The admittance number is 74,000. Only around 10% are those from the district. SOPC, there are 480,000 attendances, but only 12% of them are from that district. And Wong Tai Shin Hospital, there is no SOPC service even. So people are puzzled. How come that the three hospitals in Wong Tai Shin are not being patronized by the residents? The residents have to go to other districts to get service. And the fourth, the redevelopment of OLMH. The secretary said many times that the Kai Tak Hospital will serve the Wong Tai Shin district. But then Kai Tak Hospital is going to be replaced QEH. So it cannot meet with the tremendous needs in Kowloon East. So put simply, I hope that the secretary can face up to the problems highlighted by the members. There is indeed an urgent need to improve the services in Kowloon East.
Ms. Eunice Yong, according to the HA's website, the purpose of having clusters is to ensure that within the same district, patients can have a prolonged and a quality treatment. So from a start of disease, to treatment, rehabilitation, and community care, they can have access to continued and quality care. To achieve this purpose, all hospitals in the same cluster must complement one another so that hospitals in the same sector can provide comprehensive and complementary services for patients. So hospitals within the same sector should cooperate. Kowloon East has the lowest number of hospitals. There are only three: UCH, Haven Hope, and Chang Kwan O. Many are serving residents of Kun Tong and Sai Kung Ho, Chang Kwan O. Recently, Chang Kwan O population has risen rapidly. It's now 400,000. It's continuing to grow. So there will be a great demand for public health care services. The government must further enhance the supply of public health care services in Chang Kwan O to cope with the rapidly increasing population. I have understood with Chang Kwan O district councillors in the southern district there, there is no general outpatient clinics. They have to go to the northern part in Chang Kwan O hospital. But many those living in the southern part of Chang Kwan O, elderly persons in particular, are very far away from the general OPD. So they don't want to travel that far. They'd rather not see a doctor when they are sick. So some elderly persons have seen their diseases getting more serious because of that. So the government must honor its undertaking and provide OPD services in the southern part of Chang Kwan O ASAP. I understand that in Area 56 Chang Kwan O, there is land reserved for primary health care. I urge the administration to expedite the construction of outpatient clinics on that site.
to address the aspirations of the residents. And there should be more general outpatient clinic places, and the telephone appointment system should also be enhanced. I'm sure this will help to alleviate the pressure on current clinics. Zhang Guan Au Hospital was planned to provide obstetrics and services, but now that is not possible, and there is no maternity wards there. Mothers-to-be have to go to far away to give birth and not in Zhang Guan Au. This is very inconvenient to young couples there and has also added to the pressure of UCH. So if jungle residents would like to visit dental clinics, they have to go to either Sai Kung or Kun Tong Jockey Club clinics. And they already the nearest dental clinics, although they still have to travel to another district. However, the places are limited, so for elderly services, it's not easy for them to get a slot to see the dentist. We have a severe shortage of dental services from the public sector. I know this is not provided by the DHA, but for the Department of Health instead. The Department of Health has taken up the provision of service to ensure that we can promote oral health and treat oral diseases. After many years of development in the public healthcare sector, I wonder whether the administration has the intention to provide dental services in the public sector. If the answer is yes, I'm sure many of you have encountered this problem. You don't know where you can go to public dentist. You don't know where the clinics are. This is because the government has overlooked the need for dental services. Perhaps they want the community to rely on private dentists. If that's the case, the government is being very irresponsible. Our public healthcare sector suffers a shortage of manpower. In 2016-17, as at end March 2014, in Kowloon East cluster, there are 627 doctors. The ratio of doctors to hospital is 1,000 to 0.6. And for every elderly person over 65 years old, there is so for one every 1,000, there is only 4.1 doctors. So the ratio for Kowloon East is the lowest among the seven sectors of the HA, and the nursing supply is also the lowest. So the problem of manpower shortage in Kowloon East is the worst among the other six clusters. The government must take appropriate measures to alleviate the burden on Zhang Guan Au, a general outpatient clinic must be built in the southern part of Zhang Guan Au. There should be dental services, and the OMB services should start in Zhang Guan Au, and Zhang Guan Au and UCH and Haven of Hope Hospital's expansion should proceed quickly in order to cope with the needs associated with an aging population. Thank you. Does any member wish to speak? Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Porte. Madam Deputy, in principle, I support Mr. Wilson Orr's motion and also the amendments from members. Mr. Wilson Orr has spoken on the provision of public health care services in Kowloon East, and he also said that all districts in Hong Kong need more subsidized public health care services. Now, for Kowloon East, according to my understanding, I agree with Mr. Wilson Orr entirely. In terms of waiting time, it tops the list, and therefore we must do more to help Kowloon East. I also agree that we need to improve resources for all clusters in Hong Kong. And Kowloon East has a higher elderly population, and therefore, undeniably, we must give them more resources. Since other members have expanded the topic to cover other districts, I may as well say that prevention is better than cure. if we can enhance people's awareness in prevention, then we can remove the risks at source and then subsequently spare the expenses for treating diseases. Allow me to share with you my experience in serving the community. Now, for Kowloon East, the lead hospital is UCH. We had donation campaigns this year and last year, and UCH has a very heavy burden. It has to serve the whole district, and the hospital expansion project would take around 10 years. It is a government-subsidized hospital. It relies on the government for its expansion costs, and the sponsoring body of the hospital also has to sponsor, has to provide $100 million. So myself and other colleagues are trying our best to do more for UCH. A year or so ago, our CE designate came to officiate at a fundraising activity, and she asked how come we have to raise funds for the hospital given that we've provided so much to the hospital. I hope this will not become one of the jokes of the CE race. How come Mrs. Carrie Lam doesn't know the community well? If she is visiting the various districts so frequently, in fact, the sponsoring body of the hospital has to foot part of the bill for its expansion. While the government is subsidizing heavily in the expansion of the hospital, we also need help from the community. And as I said, prevention is better than cure. And therefore, in Wang Tao Hum, we have got a mobile health van. It's a project jointly run with Poly U, so as to provide checkups, free checkups for elderly persons. We target at the so-called hidden elderly in particular. They may not be that conscious of regular body checkups. And many of them were shocked to know that they indeed had acute cases that require immediate hospitalization for follow-up heart problems in particular. So our colleagues are very happy. They, from time to time, they come back to say that, well, luckily we identify some needy elderly for medical health care services. And we've also got an organization, Angel for DMs. We go to various places in Kowloon East to educate the public on a diet of low sugar and or even sugarless diet is health education. This can help them to prevent a lot of diseases. And our ward office in Au Tau Kok has been providing in cognitive and hearing tests free of charge to members of the public. Mem Chair, you might have provided similar services in five districts in Hong Kong. Don't overlook the importance of such minor services, because in the long term, they can help us to cut our medical bills. And doctors like to say that we are what we eat. So we have moved a motion in this council to ask the administration to turn food waste to biofuel. This will help to promote healthy eating habits. And we've also asked the administration to do this a number of times, but to no avail, and that is to levy a sugar tax. The current budget or in the current CE race talked about various tax incentives. In fact, sugar tax has been put in place in many countries, and it will bring out the message that we should cut down on sugar in our diet, and this will go a long way to improve our health, and we should offer more public-private partnership programs. Recently, there is a screening for colorectal cancer, and there is also a similar scheme on cataract operations. Given that resources are still short, we may not be able to improve public healthcare services very quickly. These are measures that can relieve a little bit, and I hope we can do more in terms of prevention.
Professor Joseph Lee, thank you.